Today's platform speaker is Jeffrey Palmer. Jeffrey, a member of the Kiowa Tribe of Oklahoma, is an award-winning filmmaker and media artist. He describes his work as a multimedia exploration of Indigenous people's lives in 21st century America. Jeffrey recently completed his first feature film, N. Scott Momaday, Words from a Bear, which is on tap for this afternoon at 1:15 p.m., by the way, here at Ethical Culture. This work examines the life and mind of the first Native American writer to win the Pulitzer Prize for Literature. The film premiered at the 2019 Sundance Film Festival and aired nationally on the PBS series American Masters. In 2020, the film was nominated for an Emmy in support of American Masters' 33rd season for Outstanding Documentary or Nonfiction Series. The film also won the 2019 Ted Turner Award for the film that most encourages environmental stewardship. Thank you. Of Jeffrey's numerous short films, Isabel's Garden was a winner of the Bill and Melinda Gates Short Film Challenge at the 2015 Sundance Film Festival. His films have also screened at venues such as Hot Docs, the Seattle International Film Festival, the Berlinale European Market, the Academy Museum of Motion Pictures, and many others around the world. Jeffrey has received numerous awards, grants, and recognition from the Sundance Institute, ITVS, Ford Foundation, Mellon Foundation, Cornell University, and the Firelight Media Documentary Lab. Jeffrey is a member of the Directors Guild of America, the International Documentary Association, the Television Academy, and he's also an associate professor of performing and media arts at Cornell University. Jeffrey is currently working on and completing a project for the Barack Obama Foundation and the Obama Presidential Center in Chicago, Illinois. Looking forward to updates on that work. Let's give a warm welcome to our guest today, Jeffrey Palmer.
Thank you so much for the introduction. I want to start by thanking the New York Society for Ethical Culture for inviting me on the Sunday platform the eve before Indigenous Peoples Day, and for providing a space to speak to you all about N. Scott Momaday and Kiowa storytelling. Since we are on the eve of Indigenous Peoples Day, it's important for me to acknowledge, and I'm wanting to repeat the land acknowledgement because I do think it's important, that we are currently working and living on the ancestral homelands of the Lenape people and associated tribes, many of whom were forced to reside in my home state of Oklahoma. Over the last 10 years, I have made films that press against taboo subjects in Kiowa culture. Some of those stories inspire Kiowa people who have not heard those stories in some time, and some are critically challenged and resurrect generational trauma. I accept that role as an artist, but it is not without its own traumas for me. So I want to say that this weekend will be the last time I talk about this film and N. Scott Momaday. So close to his death and the void it is leaving this year on Indigenous Peoples Day, it has a heaviness that I can only attribute to a Kiowa moral. We shouldn't speak publicly of people who have journeyed on. In the future, the film will speak for itself. I want to begin commenting on the title of my talk, Earthkeepers, Land Ethics, and Kiowa Storytelling, which is a public discourse in troubling times. Earthkeeper is a reference to the term coined by N. Scott Momaday in his book, Earthkeeper, Reflections of American Land. His idea of a land ethic in American life and the connection between the earth and Kiowa storytelling is highly important to this talk. It also provides perspective to the film N. Scott Momaday, Words from a Bear, which will be screened following this talk. My hope is that we continue to remember his writings and ideas of a land ethic, and that a new generation of storytellers can carry on in that tradition what I feel are teachings inclusive to everyone. I want to tell you a bit about myself and my own Kiowa experiences and why I believe that Momaday was in fact correct, that there are keepers of the earth, and that indeed there is a land ethic that exists in Kiowa storytelling. I was born and raised just outside of a tiny town of Carnegie, Oklahoma. My father, mother, brother, sister, and I lived on a small allotment of land in the middle of Kiowa country, and we spent many years there, building a life from very little. We had a modest home built for us from the tribe, an old beat-up car that my father seemed to be always working on in the front yard, and there were bodies of other cars. if you ever go to the reservation, specifically the Kiowa reservation, there's always just, most of our yards are filled with old cars. We had just enough money to buy food, clothing, and maybe a bit on the weekends to spend on a movie at the Liberty Theater or the Sonic Drive-In. We were poor, but I really didn't know that at the time. I always felt rich within the Kiowa community, and that was how I imagined it as a child. My grandfather, grandmother, aunties, and uncles were leaders of the Tongkongya, or Black Legging Society, a prestigious veteran society, and they were also prominent members of the Kiowa Gourd Clan, a ceremonial society. My family seemed to always be talking to so many people and participating in giveaways of blankets and other items, so it seemed my family was always the center of attention when I attended these events and ceremonies. My father was also the director of the Kiowa Elders Center, which was part of a tribal headquarters. It was a beautiful building in those days with large open rooms and a gigantic fireplace. I always likened it to a ritzy ski lodge in the Colorado Mountains. At least in my imagination, it was all of that and more. Every day after school, I spent my afternoons running around the whole compound, acting as a waiter, bringing an old generation of Kiowas coffee and cookies, and having casual conversations with them. Little did I know, I was talking with one of the last generations of fluent Kiowa speakers. The Kiowa language is a very pronounced, guttural, and tonal language. I could hear it pulsating through the main room, like the beating of drums. In many ways, I was the grandchild to all of these elders, and I was surrounded by storytellers. When we arrived home from a long day, Dad and I would go for walks and talk about the land, visiting certain landmarks, which we named or were named by others, Gawky Creek, the Wooden and Iron Bridge, the South Hilltop, and the Northside Woods. We would laugh at the day's events, at the Elder Center, and all of the funny things that they would say and do. In those moments, I was truly present. I truly knew who I was. I was a Kiowa boy connected to the Kiowa land. And in turn, I truly felt that I was connected to the earth. The landscape was a living being, and I had respect and connection to it. The cottonwood trees that surrounded our house and followed Gawky Creek, that straddled the south side of our land, held important meaning. My father would always tell me Same Day stories. Same Day was a trickster and magician in Kiowa stories. He was an earthkeeper. He understood the conduit that existed between the earth, animals, and people. Walking through the cottonwoods, my father told me the story of Kiowa origins. He said, The Kiowa spawned from an opening in a hollow cottonwood log. The Kiowa people were trapped in total darkness, but they could see the light through the hole. One day, Same Day was coming along, and as he came, he peered into the hole of that cottonwood tree. He saw his people trapped inside. So he asked the Kiowa people to turn themselves into ants and crawl out into the light. And so they did. And as they came out of the hole, they took human form and were surrounded by the world. They were mesmerized and gave thanks to the earth. The hole was soon plugged by a pregnant woman, leading others in the hole and in darkness. Therefore, the tribal community was quite small. As we emerged into ourselves, we named ourselves Tapeda, or the coming out people. From that story, at a young age, I understood what Momaday describes as a land ethic, that the earth is alive, and as a Kiowa, I was connected to its life force. For me, we needed to protect the land, the cottonwood trees, the ants, the earth, because it was inherently a part of us as Kiowa people. Without it, we cease to exist. And it was through the power of storytelling that I was able to make that connection. The power of storytelling has always been a source of survival for Indigenous peoples. At some point, we had to lay down our arms in the face of a colonial onslaught that threatened to destroy us in many parts of the world. In the Americas, it was almost complete annihilation. Why we survived is not so much a miracle as it was a strategy. The stories we passed down generation to generation were silently told on quiet walks or late at night, in the way that my grandfather, my father, would tell me those stories. The stories were hidden in ceremonies and in the language, and we used our storytelling and artistry to form some type of existence, despite constant oppression. It was the power of beautiful performance and exhibition that fed the minds of the colonizers. Of course, there was exploitation in this process, but we as Indigenous people knew and understood that our survival depended on our expression. One youngster born in the 1930s in Kiowa country was named Inscott Momaday. He used the power of storytelling to bring people into the light, to help them understand their disconnect from the earth. But he also reminded us Kiowas about where we came from and the importance of our ancestors and our relationship to the earth. As Momaday notes, he is an earth keeper. Eventually, we moved away to the city and became entrapped by the routine of city life. My dad and I tried in vain to recreate those walks, those moments of being present. Sadly, we were lost. I became lost, no longer present in the moment. My mind drifted away from the earth, and my thoughts centered only on the future. I became depressed and disillusioned about life. My connection with my people and the land seemed like a distant star. We only visited home on certain occasions, and sometimes we went to funeral for those elders I knew when I was a child. Eventually, my grandparents passed away, and I truly lost my relationship with the earth. One day, when I was 20-something or so, and I'm 47 right now, it's quite a while ago, I made a visit to the Kiowa Tribal Center with my father to do business or to fill out some papers, one thing or another. we made an impromptu visit to the Elders Center, where it seemed like my father had worked now for 100 years ago. The place had changed so much from when I was younger. It looked older and dingier, dark. The chatter of so many elders was gone. But it was there that I came into the presence of one of the old men who knew me when I was a child. He stared at me for a very long time with piercing blue eyes, which was very uncommon. Kiowas typically don't have piercing blue eyes. They have brown eyes. So this person was special in my mind in that moment. I remember seeing him and thinking, who is this? I feel like I know this person. He stared at me for a very long time. I was uncomfortable and shy at that moment in my life. Eventually, he waved to me to come over. I did, and in that giving moment, he began to tell me the following story, which I'm telling publicly for the first time. He said, "Kome," and "Kome" means grandson. I was sitting under a tree that was shaped like a hand, coming out of the earth. I was at my lowest point in life. My wife had died. And I was on the brink of taking my own life. I was praying underneath that tree that the land and the earth would hear my plea. And then I saw you and your dad coming down that road, that dirt road. And you both stood at the edge of the creek. And you didn't know I was there. And I watched you both as you laughed, told stories, and threw rocks into the creek. It was at that moment I decided to live my life better. I thanked the tree, the creator, you and your father, and I snuck off into the shadows of the forest. I was completely stunned by the recollection of this Kiowa elder. He was looking back at a good many years and remembered in detail that lonely dirt road, watching my father and me. He must have been in deep thought. Now, years later, he saw me and remembered my father and me walking on that particular landscape. His mind and memory flashing in recognition and making meaning of the sudden revelation. Listening to that old Kiowa, I too, in an instant, remembered those walks. Those memories came welling up in my mind. I too became involved in a magical and wonderful way with the recollection of that space and time and with the earth surrounding us. It was dreamlike and powerful. I had come into the presence of Kiowa storytelling once again. In the most dramatic and powerful way, that old Kiowa man embodied what Momaday notes, an earth keeper. As Momaday would write, it was the land and stories that informed his mind and memory. He was present to it even as he had witnessed that moment years ago. It restored him to himself, life, the earth. It also brought me back into a special place, and there was meaning for me in that special place. I felt whole again and alive in the present moment. I felt restored. I had been longing for that place, but didn't realize it in my citified mind. It was then, or I should say colonized mind, maybe. It was then that I decided that I wanted to tell stories in my own way. Today, as a filmmaker, those stories, whether consciously or subconsciously, define me as a Kiowa. It was all the landscape, the places my dad and I walked, where our forebears walked, the words of our elders, and the memories of our ancestors, and above all, the earth. For Indigenous peoples around the world, the connection to the land is of the utmost importance. The land is a conduit of tribal memory, of our origins, creation itself, subsistence, and worship. In the closing of his book, Earth Keepers, Reflections of American Land, N. Scott Momaday discusses our Mother Earth, who is buried somewhere away from us. And because of that, we no longer know or hear her. He says, she sings the songs of the earth, and that we should all listen. In this moment of climate crisis and the existential threat to our planet, instead of thinking about colonizing another planet like Mars, maybe it's time for us to listen. Thank you.